الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على محمد ابن عبد الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. ثم أما بعد، brothers and sisters, we welcome all of you to Pillars at Dar al-Quran here in Arlington, Texas, with another Friday gathering, inshallah, for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, praying and asking and begging Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to reward you for your time and for your effort, and make that, inshallah, in your righteous deed a day that nothing will benefit you except your righteous deed. Ameen ya Rabbil Alameen. Seriousness in seeking knowledge is our topic, and we will be talking for a while on that. Today I'm going to share with you a story of a revert to see how serious a person can be when he is looking for the truth, and to see that it is an obligation upon you when you become an adult to search and look for the truth, and to know that you are born knowing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but the way you are raised and the things that you learned makes you deviate away from the path. So in this story, inshallah, you will benefit from it, and that will encourage you to understand what seeking knowledge is all about. Sufficient for seeking knowledge is to know that when a person knows the purpose of the existence is to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he or she have the knowledge that what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala likes and what he wants from you and how you do it following the sunnah of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then guess what you will be doing. A very close person to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala always sees his shortcomings, not his good deeds. يعني هلا you fasted Ramadan. After Ramadan, you're not looking at how wonderful Ramadan was and how good I was and I did and I did and I did. You will be looking at little shortcomings that you did in Ramadan, and after Ramadan, how are you doing? And seeing that little shortcomings as it is everything that you're doing. What does that do to you? It mends you, it fixes you, it humbles you, it makes you fear the sin regardless how little it is. That's our problem. When we disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we look at the sin as small sin and big sin. A disobedient person or a disobedience is a disobedience regardless how small or how big. When you violate the law, there is a punishment, small or big. And when you look at Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is he? And you don't look at every sin as big sin, then it will encourage you to do more sin and bigger sins. Prophet Adam alayhi salam, what was his sin? Living in heaven, fruits and food everywhere, specific tree, don't eat from it. You have the whole heaven, just that tree, don't eat from it. So Shaitan whispered and enticed him to eat from it. Yani, look at it. When you go shopping, right? Or you do it online now. For those who go shopping, how many times you go to places and you taste the fruit before you buy it? Is it allowed? Did you ever really worry so much about it? Or go home and can't sleep? No. Prophet Adam alayhi salam did that And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgave him. Forgave him. It's not thinking he might not. When you say astaghfirullah, we don't know if he did accept our forgiveness or begging to forgive or not. Adam alayhi salam, he heard it clearly that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgave him. Yet, the day of judgment, when people go to Prophet Adam alayhi salam and ask him to intercede for them, the first thing he says, no, 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 I sinned. Go to someone else. You know, when you disobey someone, you don't want to see that person. You don't want to face him. It's so humiliating and embarrassing. Even if he forgives you, this is the righteous person. So if we get closer like that to a level where when we sin, we look at the sin as a sin rather than small or big sin, inshallah, we can reflect a little bit more. Amr ibn Abasa al-Sulami radiyallahu anhu, that's the name of the companion, Amr. He is the maternal brother of Abu Dharr, Abu Dharr al-Ghafari. Famous Sahabi Abu Dharr, this is his brother. Look what he relates a story before he accepted Islam. I will read and reflect on the words, inshallah. كنت وأنا في الجاهلية أظن أن الناس على ضلالة. He said, when I was in Jahiliyyah, Jahiliyyah is the pagan time. And the pagan time, it's time of ignorance. Everybody is ignorant. Everybody is far away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are eating dead animals. They are basically cutting their relationship. They ally to one another, right or wrong. They don't care for their relatives. They commit adultery, commit zina, drink alcohol. Every bad thing you could think of, they were doing it. So he said, when I was living in that time, I used to think that these people are misguided. And he's living amongst them. He doesn't have guidance from anyone. Yet with his own mind, with his own thinking, he concluded what people are doing is not good. You can easily do that. And sometimes when a person is doing something wrong, simply all you need to do for that person is make him think. Because a lot of times we do things we don't think. Once you start thinking, then things will clear out for you. Once you want to think, when you're talking to someone who doesn't want to listen, he's not thinking. And if he is thinking, he's not thinking in the direction of guidance. So he was thinking to himself that people were misguided. وَأَنَّهُمْ لَيْسُوا عَلَى شَيْءٍ وَأَنَّهُمْ يَعْبُدُونَ الْأَوْثَانِ He said they used to worship idols. How much intelligence it takes from a person to understand that worshiping a stone or a statue is ridiculous. How much intelligence you need that when you give food to a stone and you come back and you find the food still there and you take it and you serve him a new meal. I mean, come on. But yet people do it because they're closing their eyes. Time of Jahiliyyah is like time of blindness. It's like you close your eyes and you do a thing. So you don't know if the person ate it or not because you're blind. This is how they live. This is how closed their mind was. They don't think. That's why usually most of the misguided people, all you need to do is get them to think. If you get them to think, you succeed most of the time, or at least you wake them up. So he was thinking to himself that they're not doing the right thing. He said, فَسَمِعْتُ بِرَجُلٍ بِمَكَّةٍ يُخْبِرُ أَخْبَارًا He said, I heard about a person telling stories in Mecca, referring to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He's saying things, stories. So he's looking for the truth. يقول فقعدت على راحلتي I sat on my animal, meaning I wanted to head out and go to Mecca and see that person, what is he telling. فقدمت عليه فإذا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم مستخفيا جراء عليه قومه. He said, so I went there and there he is, Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. Of course he doesn't know him at that time. And he said he was hiding simply because his people, his own people, were so against him and basically treating him with everything that usually a person would not do. This is how courageous in evil, doing evil against him. That's why he is hiding. يعني undercover. He's not clearly calling people to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. يقول فتلطفت. So I dealt with it likewise. I did not make it too clear. I just gently and easily got in there to get to him so I can ask him. I don't want them to see me or to think that I'm coming to do anything. I don't want them to feel anything different. He said, دخلت عليه بمكة. I approached him in مكة. فقلت له. So he was in front of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. And look at the questioning. He said, ما أنت؟ ما أنت؟ If you want to say who are you, you say من أنت. If you say ما أنت, you're talking to an inanimate thing. يعني if you say ما هذه الطاولة, ما هذا الكتاب, you say that about inanimate things. But for a person, you say من أنت. So he is saying ما أنت. He's not coming to ask the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, who are you? He's coming to see, what do you have? That's why he said, ما أنت. قال, أنا نبي, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. He did not tell him, I am Muhammad, because he's asking about what he does. He told him, I'm a prophet. فقلت, وما نبي? So I asked him, what do you mean, prophet? Explain, talk more. قال, أرسلني الله. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent me. He didn't tell him who's Allah. You know why? Because he knows him. Everyone knows Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Muslim and kafir. They're just misguided about identifying him because of all the fake stories and everything and innovation that comes. So he said, أَرْسَلَنِي فَقُلْتْ وَبِأَيِّ شَيْءٍ أَرْسَلَكْ. What did he send you with? قال أرسلني بصلة الأرحام. He said, he sent me to command people to reach their kinship. Weird, right? Why didn't he say something else? The scholar said, because Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم advances certain things where it is common amongst people. يعني it was common, too common amongst people that they cut their relationship with relatives. So he wants to bring out something really good and different to make them or to attract them to Islam or to the sun. And then he added, وَكَسْرِ الْأَوْثَانِ, and to break the idols. وَأَنْ يُوَحَّدَ اللَّهِ, and to call Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala one and by himself only. لَا يُشْرِكْ بِهِ شَيْئًا, لَا يُشْرَكْ بِهِ شَيْئًا, and not to associate partners with him. So he focused on knowing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, identifying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and taking care of kinship. And this is really relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and relationship with people. And because people, if you are not good with close people to you, you expect yourself to be good to far away people. So you start with the people who are close to you. So Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم told him that. So Amr رضي الله عنه قال فمن معك على هذا? Who's with you on this? يعني did anyone believe you? Is anyone with you? طبعا when he's asking those questions, he has plans in his head. It's not like you probably think that he asked that question because he wants to go with the flow. Is too many people with him, then he's going to jump on it. No, this man is more, more intelligent than what you think. He is taking a journey on himself, looking for the truth. So every question has its يعني moral. قال حر وعبد. He said a free person and a slave person. And he meant by the free person Abu Bakr al-Siddiq. And by the slave person Bilal radiallahu anhu. So he said, I have a slave and a free person. طيب فقلت إني متبعك. So he said, I'm on with you. I want to become a Muslim. He didn't tell him, oh, only two? Now, what is he calling for? He's calling for the complete opposite of what is common amongst people, which really doesn't make sense to him to start with. So he came with something confirming what his natural disposition that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us with, which is believing and knowing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and being good to ourselves and relatives. قَالَ إِنِّي مُتَّبِعُكَ قَالَ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ إِنَّكَ لَا تَسْتَطِيعُ ذَلِكَ يَوْمَكَ هَذَا. He told him, I don't think you can do that today. This is not to say, oh, your Islam is rejected. It's like, إِنِّي مُتَّبِعُكَ, meaning, I am entering Islam and coming with you. I'm not going back to my family. I am going with you, يعني following with you, calling people to Islam. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam at that time knows that Muslims, how many people? Him, a slave, and a free man. يعني three people against all Mecca. They don't have power. He cannot protect him. He cannot provide any service for him. He was, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, advising him like a caring person for his followers. So he told him, it's not a good time for you to come with me. Yes, you are a Muslim, you accepted Islam, but don't come with me. أَلَا تَرَى حَالِي وَحَالَ النَّاسِ. Can't you see? Look how we are hiding, and look how people are dealing with us and everything. You cannot do that. وَلَكِنْ ارْجِعْ إِلَىٰ أَهْلِكَ. But I advise you, keep your Islam, go to your family and to your where you came from, continue on your Islam, do يعني what you can with the Islam, secretly of course. And then he said, فَإِذَا سَمِعْتَ بِي قَدْ ظَهَرْتُ فَأْتِنِي. If you hear about me, now I am rising up and I have some power, where I can defend you and defend my followers, then come and meet me. What does this tell you? Take a guess. This is a prophecy of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam that he will succeed. He did not say if. He said when you see me successful, come. So basically he told him, sooner or later I'm going to rise up, at that time you come and I will take care of you. قال فذهبت إلى أهلي. So he followed the advice, he went to his family. وقدم رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم المدينة وكنت في أهلي. He said, time later, Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم migrated to Medina. And he said, and I was still with my family. فجعلت أتخبر الأخبار وأسأل الناس حين قدم المدينة. He said, I'm continuing to check around everywhere about him and his situation when he went to Medina and gathering information to see what happened to him. Do you know how long is that after he accepted Islam? Take a guess. $1 if you guess. Huh? No.
I'm guessing 1 year.
How many?
1 year.
1 year?
13.
13? Brother, they exhausted all the answers. 13 years, Prophet Muhammad ﷺ called to Islam in Mecca. before he migrated to Medina. So this companion accepted Islam 13 years secretly. He did not have much information about Islam. He did not have but this meeting with the Prophet ﷺ. He lived up to it 13 years, continuing to seek knowledge and looking what happened to the Prophet so he can follow him and get in that religion. SubhanAllah. This tells you how decisive and how serious he is in seeking knowledge. قال حتى قدم علي نفر من أهل المدينة فقلت ما فعل هذا الرجل الذي قدم المدينة. Then at one time he saw some people coming from Medina, so he went and he said, what is that person who came to you in Medina doing? How is he doing? Or who is he? Yeah, and he basically acting like he doesn't know him. He just want to find out just like the rest of the people. قالوا الناس إليه سراء. They told him, and look how he said, how is that man? As if he never met him, doesn't know him, or anything. So he, because he doesn't know whom he's talking to. So he wants to make it undercover, and they also continue to talk to him undercover, so people who are listening will not know what's going on. So they said, oh, people are rushing to him. وَقَدْ أَرَادَ قَوْمُهُ قَتْلًا. And his people want to kill him. Now we know before he migrated, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, they gathered in the courtyard, all the disbelievers, and they decided what to do to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And guess who attended the meeting? You're not going to guess it. Shaytan, Hassan. Can you imagine Shaytan came looking like an old man, attending that? You know why an old man? You're not going to guess that. Why an old man, not a young man? Oh, mashallah. This guy is something. Yes. That is why I always wonder from youngsters nowadays, when parents advise you or an older person advise you, you don't take it as serious as you're supposed to. And you would take the advice of your classmate or a brother or sister who is your age more than your parents or someone older than you. And that is definite misguidance. And this is not the right path. You should respect age, because every year is a year of experience. I may pass an information to you that it took me 4 years or more to get it, and I pass it to you in a minute. You don't have to work 4 years to get it. So it reminds me one time a plumber came to person's house with his experience and knowledge. He just went, and matters of minutes he figured out the problem, and he told him, I got this and this and this. How much is the bill? 500. So the guy looked at it as 500 in 5 minutes? That's a ripoff. But for him to know in 5 minutes what your problem is, he probably lived 20 years of experience, and God knows how much knowledge he read and studied and asked and messed up and lost money and everything to get to that level. This worth money. Just like what I told a person the other day, I said, when you go to the doctor and he checks you in 10, 15 minutes and asks you for $300, $400, you're paying for his experience. You're paying for the time that he spent when you were messing around and playing. He was buried between the books and depriving himself from everything while you enjoyed yourself 10, 15 years and he was just doing what. So this is experience, and that makes a difference. So he said, They came to him and he said, what did the person come? And he said, people are about to kill him. فقال الناس إليه صراع. So we were talking about the story. So people gathered, Shaitan came dressed like an old person from Najd, an area. And they were suggesting, what should we do? Should we expel him? Should we jail him? Should we kill him? Every time they say something, he steps in. No, that's not a good thing. You expel him, he's going to make believers wherever he goes, and he's going to gather his forces and come back to you. Jail him? No. When a person talks, it will come out. Kill him? If you kill him, he has some people who still back him up. This is pagan time. What is pagan time? They will support each other regardless, right or wrong. So this old man steps in. He was sitting quiet. The shaitan, you know, he's a good person. He's a good listener. After they finish, he said, I have an idea. Gather one from each tribe and all of you at one time hit him, kill him. His blood will be spread amongst all tribes. They cannot fight everybody. Of course, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam the plan, and that's when he migrated. And who slept in his place, brother? You know a person called Ali ibn Abi Talib, his uncle? Would you do that, brother? You know someone is wanted, the entire universe is after him, and you go sleep in his room and wear his clothes? That takes courage. But look what Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told Ali radiallahu anhu. Now Al-Hussein is going to say that's why he did it, but I prove it wrong, Shaykh. He told him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who will sleep in my bed and nothing will happen to him? I guarantee him nothing will happen to him. So you're guaranteed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala you'll not be harmed. Even with that, would you still do that? It's easy for you to say yes. You may say yes. But when you get to the real thing, it's not the same. This is like someone having a pit bull. Vicious, like when you look at him, you see anger all over his face. And he's about to tear you apart. And then the owner, which you trust and you know, he tells you, don't be afraid. He's a kind dog. He's a gentle dog. Would you trust him? Keep his kindness, brother. You never know. All it takes is one mistake. Now, so, the same way you feel. That's why sometimes people ask you questions. They say, if you see your place in Jannah when you are in the grave, the day of judgment, when you are going to receive your book and all that, you already know that you saw your place in Jannah. Assuming you do, and you know, and you see the mess going around, and you see the sun, and you see the people begging, and you see the hellfire, and you think you're going to trust something you saw in the grave, that you're going to get the Jannah, or even remember or talk about it. Every situation is different. And that's why when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talked to us about things like that, He sort of, you feel like it's isolated from things you already know, because this is like the people, if your good deeds and bad deeds are equal, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us about a place called A'raf. A'raf is a hill between heaven and hell. So you have heaven and hell, in between there is a hill. Who is on it? People whose good deeds and bad deeds are equal. One good deed more than bad deed puts you in Jannah. One bad deed more than good deed, when? That's why when we said, don't ever belittle a sin. One, you know how one is? As small as a mustard seed. as tiny as an atom will make a decision to put you in Jannah and hellfire. Sometimes a person who wants to argue or talking to him about smoking, haram and all of that, he said, oh, Sheikh, you know, I just smoke a cigarette, you know, one or two a day. Yeah, and if for one or two you say I'm going to go to hell? I said, yes. Now he takes it, Sheikh Hassan is saying, if you smoke a cigarette, you go to hell. No, that's not what I mean. I mean it from here. If your good deed and bad deed are equal, and you smoked a cigarette before you died, and put your bad deed more, you end up in hell. This is what I meant. I don't mean one bad deed will put you. No, I mean if it's over the balance. So, if you are on the hill, now I know and you know, eventually you go to Jannah, you go to heaven. But if you are there, you think you're going to be, aha, check this out, look who's there in hell, and this is, yeah, I know I'm going to Jannah. People who are sitting there on that hill begging Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to put them in the people of Jannah, and begging Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect them from those people. In fact, they don't want to look. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَإِذَا صُرِفَتْ أَبْصَارُهُمْ يعني صُرِفَتْ أَبْصَارُهُمْ يعني someone else like turned their head. It's like, look over here. He doesn't want to look. He knows hellfire is there. He doesn't want to see. You know how sometimes you see something scary or something. I mean, how many of you like to look at a mouse? You know, the garage mouse? Wallahi, brother, I mean, I expect women to do that, not you. You mean to tell me if you have a mouse in your house, you run away?
I'll take care of it.
Oh, you'll take care of it. Hmm. I thought you would run away from it. Well, that's taking care of it. If you run away, he follows you, he'll close the garage and you're done. You don't want to look at something that you're too scared of. So this is the idea. Look, so the shaitan dressed and gave the recommendation. Eventually, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam left. So that is what those people were saying. They are about, or his people were about to kill him, and that's why he came to Medina. Then he said, فَلَمْ يَسْتَطِيعُ ذَلِكَ. They could not do that. Why? Because he eventually made it to Medina. فَقُلْتْ مَا فَعَلَ هَذَا الرَّجُلْ الَّذِي قَدِمَ الْمَدِينَةِ. So he asked him, and they told him that. يقول فدخلت عليه فقدمت المدينة فدخلت عليه. Now picture this. He lives in Mecca. He accepted Islam 13 years ago. Met the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam one time. Not much education he learned from him. We'll see what he learned from him. Continued on his seriousness 13 years. Now he is in Medina. 500 kilometers. There is no aeroplane, there is no Mercedes or BM or those cars that will fly him there. He has to walk or travel or an animal. He traveled. He told him, remember what he told him? When you see him strong, come. So he traveled to Medina. فَقُلْتُ And he went to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Check this. فَقُلْتُ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ أَتَعْرِفُنِي. Wow. You know, I meet the brothers here every week. And every time I tell them, what's your name? Wallah, sometimes the person I meet, he is sitting. I know him. When he stands up, who are you? People different. Prophet, not all people like that. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam met him one time. So he came to him. 13 years after that, yani the person changes, could be young, becomes old, it's not easy. فَقَالَ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهُ وَسَلَّمْ نَعَمْ أَنْتَ الَّذِي لَقِيتَنِي بِمَكَّةِ Told him, yes, you're the one who came to me in Mecca. قَالْ فَقُلْتُ بَلَى Yes, O Prophet of Allah, I am the one. فَقُلْتْ يَا نَبِيَ اللَّهِ أَخْبِرْنِمْ عَمَّا عَلَّمَكَ اللَّهِ وَأَجْهَلُهُ He said, O Prophet of Allah, teach me what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught you, and I don't know it. You know, yani usually the best that we do as good seekers of knowledge is we go when someone tells us, come, there is a lecture, you go to it. How many of us go to the house of a sheikh or a scholar and ask him to teach him? Or to know a question, to answer a question or something? Very, very, very few. 13 years, traveled 500 kilometers or more, and he is asking the Prophet ﷺ to teach him. فقال أخبرني عن الصلاة. He told him, teach me about salah. Why salah? Who are you if you don't have salah? Brother, did you pray Maghrib? How important salah is? If you don't have salah, a lot of people have problems, marital problems. You might have it when you tomorrow get married. The first thing that a person would ask you to counsel you, do you pray on time? Do you miss salah? Good. Do you deal with haram? Do you deal with riba? And you start naming major sins. If you do what you're supposed to do, salah especially, and stay away from major sin, then we can help you because you have good relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If I advise you, if I were to read on you, make ruqya or something, only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can heal you, not me. So you have to have good relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he started with the salah. قال أنت الذي لقيتني. Okay. قال عن الصلاة. قال صلي صلاة الصبح. So now the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is teaching him salah. Take those little guidelines here, inshallah, about salah and see how he taught him. He told him pray Fajr prayer. What is Fajr? First salah. When does Fajr start? The crack of the dawn. When does the dawn crack? When the night is over. When is the night over? You have time for it. That is the beginning of Fajr prayer. He told him, pray Fajr prayer. ثُمَّ اقصر اقصر عن الصلاة حتى تطلع الشمس حتى ترتفع. He said, pray Fajr, then don't pray anything else. Until the sun rises. And how long is that? And he measured it like an arrow length. And how much is that? About 15 minutes. يعني, when you pray Fajr, you cannot pray after that. If you want to pray more voluntarily, you can. That's not the time. Until the sun, about 15 minutes after it rises. We'll see why. فَإِنَّهَا تَطْلُعُ حِينَ تَطْلُعُ بَيْنَ قَرْنَي شَيْطَانَ وَحِينَ إِذٍ يَسْجُدُ لَهَا الْكُفَّارِ. He said the reason is because when the sun rises, Shaitan knows some people worship the sun. His arrogance, you know how show off people, they try to stick themselves in every gathering, in every situation to show up, you know. They will stick to a celebrity or someone who is يعني famous and take a picture with him or be in a place that there should not be, but they do everything. Shaitan does the same thing because he is the leader of all arrogant people. So the shaitan does what? Here is the sun is going to rise from here. Shaitan has two horns. What does he do? He stands behind where the sun rises. When people bow for the sun, they're bowing actually for him too. That's how arrogant he is. So it looks like they are worshiping him along with the shaitan, with the sun. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is saying, differ than people. Yes, you are worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but this time the disbelievers are worshiping the sun Don't share with them that time. Hold back. You don't want to get confused with someone who might think you're doing the same thing. Stay away from it. Anything specific for the disbelievers, religious things, as a Muslim, you should not enter it, you should not do it, you should not do anything that even looks like it. That is for things that is special for worship. So, he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ثُمَّ صَلِّي فَإِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ مَشْهُودَ مَحْضُورَ حَتَّى يَسْتَقِلَّ الظِّلُّ بِالرُّمْ. If you have a pen, share? Thank you. He said, then after the sun rises 15 minutes, pray all you want to pray until, pretend this is the arrow. If you put it under the sun, what happens? It will have a shadow. The shadow is from the west when the sun is rising from the east. When the sun gets here, now the shadow in the west keeps shrinking, 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 until when the sun here, the shadow is exactly the arrow, no shadow. This time, don't pray. Until the shadow starts to show from the east, because the sun will be on the west side. Why don't do it when you're here? Let's see what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said. قال ثم أقصر عن الصلاة فإن حينئذ تسجر جهنم. He said at that time hellfire will be blazed, extremely blazed. Now remember, hellfire is here. يعني hellfire is created. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala أعدت للكافرين, he said, prepared, يعني done and there. So the hellfire is blazed at that time. And when the sun is here and the hellfire is blazed and you are going to pray, what does praying do? It's a blessing for you. It's a mercy for you. It doesn't match. Hellfire is a punishment. Hellfire is getting blazed and you are doing prayer at the same time. They don't go along together, so don't pray at that time. This is like the Surah Bara'a in the Quran. The beginning of it, it says Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alienating the disbelievers. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alienates someone, he's finished. He's cursed forever. And that's why you don't say, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. You cannot say, by the name of Allah, the most merciful, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is alienating and cursing everyone. It just doesn't match. So the same way here, when the sun, so we have two times so far. When the sun rise until it is about an arrow length, which is about 15 minutes, and when the sun on top of the sky, that time, give it another 15 minutes until the shadows start to show, then you can pray. And that's why we wait. Yani Dhuhr Salah starts about 15 minutes after the sun in the middle of the sky. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told him that. يقول فإذا أقبل الفيء فصلي. Then when the shadow of the stick, يعني if you put it, start to show about 15 minutes, then pray, because at that time the salah is witnessed by the angels to record it for you and to pray with you also. ثم أقصر عن الصلاة حتى تغرب الشمس. Then now. The second time? The first time when the sun rises, the second time when the sun in the middle of the sky, the third one is what I'm going to say now.
How do you know it's in the middle? How do you know it's in the middle?
How do you know it's in? Yeah, without a clock, if you have anything, a stick, put it under the sun. If the sun in the middle of the sky, it will be directly on it, so it has no shade. That is the time that you don't pray. And that extends to about 15 minutes. Then the shade starts to show from the east because the sun will pass to the west. Yani if you're standing and the sun is in the west and you are facing it, your shadow will be behind you. Sah? Try it. Inshallah. From wherever the sun rises, the shadow is in the opposite direction. So if you were to count it, just count it in our time, midday, extra 15 minutes. Sunrise, extra 15 minutes. Sunset, about 15 minutes before. After Asr, you cannot pray anyway, voluntarily, but it gets really hated if you pray at the time of sunset, because also the shaitan is going to stand behind the sun and looks like that people, this is when they bow for the sun, and shaitan will be like he's worshipped also along with the sun. So three times you don't pray simple voluntary prayers. Sunrise, 15 minutes after, midday, 15 minutes after, and just before the sun sets, you cannot pray or make any extra prayer. And then he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَحِينَئِذٍ يَسْجُدُ لَهُ الْقَوْمُ فَقُلْتِ يَا نَبِيَ اللَّهِ. Now, of course, you have Maghrib. Maghrib, when the sun sets completely. And then if you look at the brighter horizon, you see not the school. Yani the horizon, the bright horizon. Yeah, there's a school, brighter horizon. When you look where the sun sets, you see redness of the sun. When the redness disappears completely, that's the time of Isha. This is for people who don't have a watch, and you probably think that you will never use it. You will use it. Sometimes you never know where you go. If you travel and you go places, you need to understand the tayammum, you need to understand the time without the clock, you need to understand how to find directions and all of that. It will benefit you, so it's not a waste of knowledge that people are teaching you. Now, of course, after Isha, now we've done the prayers. So this is what the Prophet ﷺ taught him, the five daily prayers, and told him where to not pray extra. Because anytime you pray the obligatory prayers, you can pray more. There's nothing better than extra prayer for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, what do you need for the prayer, brother? Before you pray, what do you need? What do you do? You make wudu. By the way, I'm asking the brother because he is like Amr ibn Abasa. You know, Amr ibn Abasa is a revert, and brother Enrique is a revert too. You're a revert? Okay. Why are you laughing, bro? Oh, because I'm laughing. Alhamdulillah. Now, he wants to learn wudu. Let's see how good your wudu is. قال قلت يا نبي الله الوضوء حدثني عنه. O Prophet of Allah, tell me about the wudu. فقال ما منكم رجل يقرب وضوءه فيتمضمض ويستنشق فينتثر. Anyone who gets his wudu, pay attention, I'm going to ask you a question. He swishes his mouth and spits three times, and sniffs the water and blows his nose three times. You sniff with the right hand, you blow your nose with the left hand. You eat with the right hand and you shake hands with the right hand. You clean yourself in the bathroom with the left hand, not with the right hand. Now someone, some cute person is going to come and tell me, what if your right hand is broken? Why we always talk about exceptions? Yeah, what do you expect me to tell you? Don't go to the bathroom? Okay. So you look, you bring your wudu, you swish your mouth, nose. What happened to hands? He didn't say that. Washing your hands is not a pillar of wudu. It's a sunnah. Yani, if you start mouth, nose, face, arms, here you wash your hands. Arms, not from here to here, arms from here, tip of your finger to here. So for those cute people who wash it from here to here, your wudu is invalid if you did not wash your hands. Almost everybody washes from here to here. Sah? Did you ever wash it from here to here? So we pray and hope that when you start with the hands, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will let it go for you because you already washed your hand. But the right wudu, even if you wash it in the beginning, that sunnah, you still have to wash it from here to here when you wash your hand to the elbow. So keep that in mind. Now, when you swish your mouth and your nose and you blow your nose and you wash your mouth, he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this is the reward. يقول خرت خطايا وجهه وفيه وخياشيمه. All the sins committed by your mouth, by your nose, and by your face will be washed off. I know, what kind of sin you commit with your nose, bro? You don't know?
Smell.
Smell. Smell of what?
Bad things.
Tobacco?
Many things. Like, you can be more than one thing.
Are you sure you don't know? Everybody smiling is undercover. The only thing I'm thinking of smelling is women perfume. This is prohibited to purposely smell it. I'm not talking purposely you go buy a bottle and smell it. No, I'm not. I'm talking off of a woman. Yani, if a woman wears perfume, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, if she wears the perfume and she passes by men so that they smell her perfume, when they smell her perfume, what are they going to do? They're going to look at her. Then she committed a form of zina. Now we know zina is different forms. Touching is a form of zina. Smelling is a form of zina. Looking is a form of zina. Listening is a form of zina. Walking to something is a form of zina. And then the real zina. That is the worst. And the sin, we need to understand that the sins vary and differ in evil. Yani, if I say touching is a zina, it's not going to be the same sins like looking or like smelling. Each one is different than the other. The one that gets you closer and more to the real zina is the most sinful or evil. But all of them forms. That's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, it has been prescribed that every person will earn his portion of zina. Every person. Because it's impossible to find someone who never looked or touched or any of those. But this is just to let you know that the sins of your nose, the sin, yani, how do you commit a sin with your nose smelling? If a woman passes by perfume, smell perfume, you smell the perfume, you know she's a woman, and then you walk behind her smelling the perfume. That is haram. And this, the wudu, erases that sin. Same thing with your face. What kind of a sin your face commits? A lot? Aha. Because when you say face, you're including eyes, and you're including mouth, and you're including nose. Okay, if the nose is taken care of, and the mouth is taken care of, then you still have your eyes. That would be erased. Then, because of the wudu, this is the wudu that many of you run away from or don't do it properly, You need to take care of it and do it good. Then he added, صلى الله عليه وسلم, ثم إذا غسل وجهه كما أمره الله إلا خرت خطايا وجهه من أطراف لحيته مع الماء. Look how he puts it. He said, when you wash your face, then all the sins of your face would fall off from the edges and the corners of your beard. Two things here to pay attention to. Number one, he's talking about women, right? Yes? No. He's talking about men, but women are included, not the beard. The reason I said that, because you think every man has a beard? Then how is it going to work? It will still erase it. But the majority of men have beard, or supposed to have the beard. Exceptions are the one who don't have a beard. And that's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that sins fall from the corners and the edges of the hair of their beard, because when we have commands, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make a command, it is for the majority, not for the minority or for the exceptions. Exception has no rule. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is talking to people who are generally have beard. If you don't have a beard, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not give you a beard, your sin will still fall off. And that would be from the exception of not having the beard. ثم يغسل يديه إلى المرفقين. Look, he did not say he washes his elbow. He said he washes his hands to the elbow. Hands from here to the elbow. So you do that. Then he said, صلى الله عليه وسلم, ثم, يعني, of course, when you do that, the same thing, the sins committed by your hand will be falling off. ثم يغسل قدميه إلى الكعبين. Then he washes his feet to the ankles. Not to it, including it. And that's why I told you before, if you want to wipe over your socks, يعني you made wudu, and you wore the socks, you can wipe over it 24 hours. But your socks have to cover your ankle. Because the parts that you wash has to be completely covered to be able to wipe on it. So pay attention, if you have cute socks, wiping over it doesn't work. Cute socks is the socks that doesn't cover the ankle, because you want to be so comfortable with your shoes. Yeah, how comfortable, brother? Getting comfortable with cutting something and saving yourself from hellfire. Then he said, صلى الله عليه وسلم, فإن هو قام فصلى فحمد الله وأثنى عليه ومجده بالذي هو أهل له وفرغ قلبه لله إلا انصرف من خطيئته كهيئته يوم ولدته أمه. Now if you do this and you glorify Allah سبحانه وتعالى, after you finish, you say, what's the dua? أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله اللهم اجعلني من التوابين واجعلني من المتطهرين. If you do that, يعني you finish the wudu and you glorify Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with anything, doesn't have to be exactly this, then you will be like a newborn baby. All of your sins are erased. That's wudu, Shaykh. Imagine when you have wudu for that. Wudu does that. And salah does that. Imagine how merciful Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imagine how wonderful the salah. You wake up in the morning. You start with the salah. Then between Fajr and Dhuhr, you commit so much sins. Every time you wudu or when you make wudu, erases your sins. If it did not do the full job because of some shortcomings here and there, the salah takes care of it. Then when you sin between Dhuhr and Asr, the Asr takes care of it. And that's why the Prophet ﷺ, there's a hadith that says, تحترقون تحترقون. You're burning, you're burning. Then he says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Then the prayer for Dhuhr comes, then you're forgiven. Then you're burning. The Salah comes for Asr, you pray, you're forgiven, and so forth. So that is the specialty of the wudu and the specialty of the Salah at this great hadith. So Amr ibn Abbas radiallahu anh is the companion who lived, who looked and searched for the truth, learned it, was patient on it, traveled for it, sincere with it, learned the Salah and learned the wudu, and mashallah, saves you from everything else. And that is the beginning story. We'll continue talking about seeking knowledge, how we do it, and what are the things that the main things that we do, inshallah, in the next lecture. For the meantime, if you have any question, we can have some question. I always like to give you the glad tidings of how wonderful you are planning to come and giving up maybe, God knows what other plans you have to give up to come here or to plan here. Seriousness in seeking knowledge, it's not like at the spur time that you have, I have time, I go. No, it is when you make a plan. It's like you're coming to this lecture every Friday. Don't make any plans in that time. Any plans you want to make it before. And this is dedication. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala likes. This is how you gain knowledge. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that Allah subhanahu or he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he used to do something, he used to stay steadfast on it. It's not like one time here, one time there. And you will see how it will connect you with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and will be so special for you. Tafadhal.
I'm not sure if you forgot to add this part in the wudu, but don't you
pay attention, Shaykh, because you're going to translate.
Don't you also have to do your ears? Like wash your ears?
Yes, yeah, he did not mention it, but when I did not say the head. When he told him about the head, the ears are part of the head, they're included. That's why when you wipe your hair, you can wipe your ears with the same wiping, or you can make it an individual wipe. The ears, part of the head, not part of the face. You wash from here to here. Mouth, nose, eyes, part of the face. That's why if you see in the Quran, the pillars are four. يا أيها الذين آمنوا إذا قمتم إلى الصلاة فاغسلوا وجوهكم وأيديكم إلى المرافق وامسحوا برؤوسكم وأرجلكم إلى الكعبين. So in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, wash your face, wash your hands all the way to the elbow, wipe your head, and wash your feet. So he did not mention mouth or nose. They're included in the mouth. The sunnah showed that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to wash him, and that's why we do it.
And also, not like including the socks, but do you wash up to your ankle, right, for the feet, not all the way to the knees?
Fadda, Shaykh. Brother.
When you make wudu, you have socks on. Do you go all the way up to your, all the way up, or just you just wipe on top?
Oh, good. Assuming this is your foot, you wipe on top of it like this. Wow, your foot is bigger than that?
Do you extend to the knee?
Oh, the socks?
No. When you wash it the first time, you have to stop by here or you can go up?
No. The wiping is over your foot. Yani it is yani the sunnah is like this.
No socks, sir.
No.
No socks. Like the regular washer.
No socks? You want to wipe over your feet with no socks? من تحت؟ ما هذا اللي بحكي لكم فيه. This is your feet. You wipe it here. Did I say you go all the way to your... on top of your foot. That's it.
So she's saying,
this is your leg. Starts here, from here to here. And it doesn't have to be 100% measurement. It's just, you just do it this way. Yani Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it easy on you, and He just wants you to basically know that there is something here that you're supposed to do, and you're not. Yeah, you're not going to wash your socks. You don't do it from under, from the top, so it's not meant for cleaning. It just, Fadda.
Mayor, can you repeat the dua after you make wudu?
La ilaha illallah, wahdahu la sharika lah, lahu al-mulk wa lahu al-hamd, wa huwa ala kulli shay'in qadir.
And if you don't mind, what does that translate to?
Translate, la ilaha illallah, no deity worthy of worship except Allah. وَحْدَهُ لَا شَرِيكَ لَهُ. He is one and only one with no partners. لَهُ الْمُلْكُ وَلَهُ الْحَمْدُ. To Him belongs all the dominion and all the praise. وَهُوَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٌ. And He is able and capable to do anything. وَيَا فَضَّلْ شَهُ. Yeah, you can say the dua in the bathroom, because the bathroom is not really the bathroom. The bathroom is where you actually sit. But the sink and all of that is not really the bathroom. Yani, if you have nowhere to sleep in the house, wouldn't you sleep in the bathroom? You wouldn't? Naam. يعني هلا when you go to the bathroom, when you make dua, let's say that you go in an open area, when do you make dua? When you leave your house? That's not the question. Well, he's off the topic.
So you said the bathroom is inside where you sit. So when you make wudu...
Relax, Maho. If you answer this question, you would know what I'm talking about. If you are in Somalia, open area, when do you make the dua? Out in the desert. Walk out? You walk for an hour.
No. Whatever I'm doing, the activity,
the place where you want to go to the bathroom, at that time, you make the dua and you go. So when you actually sit where the commode is, that is the place where the bathroom is. But outside that, it's not a bathroom.
Yani,
and to use.
Can you make salam? Can you say salam when someone is walking?
You can. Yeah, you need to use best judgment. Yani, not every area, not every bathroom is the same. Yani, some places, public places, and all of that. It's better to avoid dhikr or anything in the bathroom. So if you don't know that, just avoid it or say it in your heart.
This question is kind of outside the topic, but I'm an electrician. That's my occupation. So sometimes I'll be outside. I'll be all weathers. Is it fine when it's prayer, when it's time to pray? I can just pray outside on the grass, or is if I don't have
that is a specialty of this ummah, of the ummah of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is all earth is made pure. Anywhere the salah comes, pray wherever you are. On the grass, in the street, anywhere. Avoid, yani, if there is a filthy place that you know, avoid that. Other than that, anywhere you pray. No. Tfaddal. Pizza? No.
So this Sahabi, like, he missed all the battles of Badr and Uhud, like, he participated in the battles.
Which Sahabi?
The one we're talking about.
Amr?
Yeah.
Amr ibn Abasa? What does this have to do with it?
So, like, he didn't participate, like, he's not part of the battles that happened in Mecca and Medina. Like, he met in Mecca first.
Yeah, he was in living in Mecca. I did not check, but more than likely, yes. If he is that keen on learning the religion, you think he's going to sit at home during the battle?
So it's not mentioned, like at what time he met in Medina, did he meet the Prophet
in Mecca?
Well, obviously, the way it looks, he was waiting for him by the second when he gets to Medina. So definitely, this is the beginning of his arrival to Medina. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. عشاء time. I know you're looking for pizza. Always pizza. Food. 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 Show Somalia.
Somalia.
الله أكبر الله أكبر.